everyone. My name is Shannon Olin, a motivational speaker and inspiration coach, and I am so blessed to have the opportunity to bring to you one of the most delightful women I've ever had the opportunity of meeting, Ms. Suzanne Mitchell. Ms. Suzanne Mitchell is the woman behind the Dallas Cowboys cheerleaders and what they are known as today. Suzanne, thank you so much for sitting down with me. And we are here at such an incredible convention, the former NFL Alumni Cheerleaders Association. So it's awesome to meet you and see you here today.
Thank you. Well, I just love the fact. I didn't even know that this had happened. And this is now the third year, I'm told. And the fact that this can bring all of you all together is unbelievable. An opportunity, even though you only do it every 2 years, for girls from every team in the league, those that still exist. I kind of feel sorry for the Derek Dolls and the Baltimore. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a little sad on that aspect, but they can unite with other people and we can all stay together.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I just wish more of my girls could have been there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But you did bring several of the girls.
Oh, yeah.
A few. Yeah.
Yeah. Uh-huh. I think there's five, and one drove in last night from Tennessee, 4.5 hour trip to get here. And I hadn't seen her in 30 years.
Oh, my goodness. And it just warms your heart because,
oh,
you know, it's kind of like a sorority or a sisterhood,
it is,
you know, like-minded women coming together to really just embrace what we've all been through in the NFL.
Well, and from my standpoint, see, I started the ring, that every one of my girls has a ring.
Yes.
And it says DCC on it, and I give at the end of their first season. And it has the bird of peace in the last C. And now all the girls everywhere, no matter where they go in the world, they're connected. So I love that tapestry that holds us together.
Yes.
But now we can bring everyone together with something like this.
Absolutely.
I love this, and I'm so honored to be speaking tonight.
Well, and you have such an awesome story about how you became a part of the NFL. Tell me that again.
Well, Tex Schramm, who was president of the Dallas Cowboys, he interviewed me to be his secretary assistant. And in sitting across from his desk, just having returned from my commune in New York, he didn't know that. He was surprised, because he was a very conservative guy. I'm sitting cross-legged, and he's interviewing me, and he asked me the question, what I would like to do in 10 years with the Cowboys, and I said, your chair looks really comfortable. Well, he just thought that was the funniest thing he'd ever heard. He stood up, pounded on the desk, and shook my hand and said, you're hired. And that was it. And then a month later, all the commotion in Super Bowl X, Gwenda Swearingen winked at the camera, and it was like television made the public aware that professional cheerleaders existed, because we weren't the first. The Washington Redskins were first, and then I think Los Angeles Rams, Philadelphia Eagles. I mean, everybody thinks we're first, but we weren't. But we did come in there with a bang.
Absolutely, you did.
That's good.
So as the coach of the Dallas Cowboys cheerleaders, what did you do to make them become the iconic brand that we know and love today?
Well, I had a wonderful assistant. I had a wonderful choreographer named Texie Waterman, who is no longer with us, and miss her like crazy. And she had an assistant, and then I hired, when Texie left, I hired Shannon Worthman, and she had been a cheerleader for 4 years, and she knew what the field was like and how you performed. No one does it by themselves. Basically, I hung on for a year saying no to everybody, and then I kind of figured out, how do I want the Dallas Cowboys to be represented by these young women? And you start one by one writing rules and regulations of how they're to behave and what their demeanor is to be and how they're going to present themselves. You know, I would give them courses in Dale Carnegie. I would give them etiquette courses. I would talk to them at length about the press and how they handle themselves, mainly because they're very young and overnight they become a celebrity, and nobody knows how to handle that immediately. So, you know, they did the job. It wasn't just me. The girls themselves behaved beautifully and gave the Cowboys a good reputation. And it was the public relations arm, I think, of the Dallas Cowboys for a long period of time. And to some extent still is.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, and you're so humble as a leader to say that it was, you know, a much bigger picture than just
you.
Oh,
yeah, it was.
What are some of your greatest success stories from being the coach?
Well, I think as director, I think the part that touches my heart are the 18 Department of Defense USO tours that we did. I did 11 Christmases in Korea, in the Indian Ocean and the Philippines. I've landed on 12 aircraft carriers. I've catapulted off. I've been hoisted out of helicopters onto submarines and radar sites. And I have met incredible people and heard incredible stories, both sad and happy. All of those things go into making me who I am, that I can turn around and give the gift back. Mm-hmm. And that's what I would tell my girls, that they had to understand it wasn't what was happening to them, it was what was happening through them that made a difference in everybody's life with every choice they made. Mm-hmm. So that's why they needed to be the representative that they wanted their daughters one day to mm-hmm. look back at and say, mm-hmm. that's my mom. Mm.
That is so sweet. I love that. Mm. What do you feel like was maybe your greatest challenge as being part of the organization and the team and just being out there in the public eye?
Well, I think initially it was the public's thinking they knew who these girls were. Mm-hmm. And I know the other teams probably had some of the same bad publicity. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was called a lot of names, mm-hmm. you know, a madam, a procurer of young women. Mm-hmm. And I would really either write them or call them if I got any bad stuff and say, okay, let me ask you this question. What were you doing last Christmas Eve? You were probably at home with your family in front of a warm fire, having wonderful food. Well, I had 12 girls mm-hmm. on the DMZ mm-hmm. in Korea mm-hmm. in minus 20 degrees in a flight check, mm-hmm. having gone to 11 bases mm-hmm. and done two shows mm-hmm. for their country. Mm-hmm. So what have you done for years lately?
Mm. Wow. Wow, I can't imagine getting that letter from you.
Well, how do they would write me back sometimes and mm-hmm. say, I didn't know.
Yeah, and that's the truth. The public
exactly.
doesn't understand everything that goes on behind the scenes.
No. Or how much good mm-hmm. the cheerleaders do. Mm-hmm. You know, all of the cheerleading teams, mm-hmm. they do nursing home visits, they do orphanage visits, mm-hmm. they do telethons. You know, yes, they do promotional things for businesses and mm-hmm. stuff, mm-hmm. but that's part of the PR of it mm-hmm. for their own specific team and mm-hmm. so forth. But the good that is done, mm-hmm. you don't do it to get publicity.
Right.
You do it because it needs to be done.
Right.
And that's why most people did not know what mm-hmm. my ladies did, mm-hmm. but I made sure they did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What advice would you give to young women who are maybe want to be, and they're inspired by you, and maybe they would want to follow in your footsteps and have maybe some of the, just a small fraction of the success that you've had in your life?
Well, it's kind of like, I really do believe that all of us are the choices that we make. Mm-hmm. And every choice we make affects somebody else. Mm-hmm. And that's a very important key. Mm-hmm. You need to love what you do. Marianne Williamson said, mm-hmm. if you do what you love, everything else will happen mm-hmm. and everything else will follow. Mm-hmm. Don't settle for anything in your life. Mm-hmm. Go for the gusto.
Yeah.
You know? When you feel it and it's good and it makes you happy mm-hmm. and it'll lead you into other things that you can do, if you get out of yourself and you know you're helping somebody else, mm-hmm. it'll work for you. And that, to me, is success. Mm. It's not money.
Yeah. And so, Suzanne, I know mm-hmm. things have kind of taken a little bit of a turn in your life here within the last couple of years. And tell me more about, you know, your health and kind of where things stand right now.
Well, I think basically I'm feeling that God has given me a battle to fight because mm-hmm. a year ago I was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, and we're looking at 20% of the people who get it who can even have the surgery, which is called the Whipple, mm-hmm. to where I went to Houston mm-hmm. to the Methodist Hospital, and mm-hmm. Dr. Rosenberg did the Whipple procedure on me. Mm-hmm. It's probably one of the most dangerous, difficult surgeries to do. Mm-hmm. And I didn't even know if I'd come out of it. Mm-hmm. You never know, especially at my age at that time. And they do reconnect everything in your digestive system. They remove a great many parts and obviously remove the tumor and part of your pancreas. In my situation, the fact that they got it early enough, because usually you're dead before you have it, or they find out and it's too late to do anything about it, because usually then it's spread to the liver. And I now have an opportunity to spread the word, to try to get out the awareness, and I really believe that God has given me this battle and this fight. I chose not to do radiation and chemotherapy. They said it would only be 10%, but they also said I'd be sick as a dog for 6 months. And I've been too blessed in my life to go out that way. And I figured, no, I'm going to use this time to go out and speak to people and make them more aware and let them get involved in this. So hopefully I'm doing that. And tonight at the event, I'm going to talk about it, because I think then these ladies can go home and maybe talk about it to them. And I have a former cheerleader who has done a beautiful, beautiful bracelet, which is called the Suzanne bracelet, and purple is for pancreatic cancer.
Yes.
And most of the proceeds from this, other than what it takes to make it, goes to the research for pancreatic cancer. And we also have bracelets for ovarian cancer, lung cancer, autism, heart, wounded warriors, and support the troops. So in all of those areas, through the Suzanne bracelet, of all those, we can help so many people.
Yes.
And that's what life's all about.
Absolutely. I know you've mentioned that a couple of times today, that it's a bigger picture than what we than what we think of it.
Yes, ma'am.
Is. And so can our viewers, can they get one of these bracelets?
Yes.
Is there some place that we can find them on the web?
You can find it on pancreatic cancer. If you go there, the Pancreatic Cancer Network.
Okay.
Pancan.com.
Okay.
And there's a link to get these bracelets.
Okay.
And all of the other bracelets. But there's also, for this weekend, these are cheer bracelets.
Oh my goodness.
So there's one for every team. This is the Cowboys. And their logo, and then the cheer heart. And then here's the football.
Love it.
And then the colors of the beads will be the individual
teams.
And all the girls can get their own.
Yes.
And then a part of this also goes. So,
well,
we're
trying. I'll have to get mine for Chiefs.
Okay.
And you're wearing my Chiefs colors today.
Yes, I know. I did. I did it for you.
Oh, you're so sweet. Suzanne, is there anything else that you would want to tell our audience about your life, your legacy, about making an impact in the world? Before we go.
No, just that I'm truly the luckiest lady in the world. I have just had an incredible life and been able to do what I love and worked 7 days a week, about 18 hours a day, and I loved every minute of it. I used to tell Tex I'd do it for nothing if I could. I loved it so much, and that's why I say if you do what you love, everything else will find its way to you.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Suzanne, you're such an inspiration.
Oh, thank you, darling.
Thank you.
So are you doing what you're doing. It's fabulous, Shannon.
Thank you. Appreciate it.